Hello, everyone. You hear me?
Yes.
Good audience, you know? It's big. Looking good. Before I'm going to start and start talking about serverless, just a couple of questions. How much people here in the audience come from the front-end, like front-end developers? Cool. Nice. How much people here in the audience come from the back-end side, back-end developers? Okay. Pretty much 50-50. How much people here in the audience heard about the term serverless? Cool. Ooh, impressive. How much people here come for this lecture only because it was the only English track? Yeah, appreciate the honesty. Cool. So today I'm going to talk about serverless. I want to explain a bit what serverless is. I want to explain a bit about what serverless is. What serverless is and what serverless isn't. You will excuse me for 1 minute, less if I will remember my passport. Cool. So today I want to talk about serverless, to explain really what serverless is and what serverless isn't. I know this word is like a big word right now. It's currently a big and huge buzzword. And we like to demonstrate and to explain a bit, like to make everything more clear about what serverless really is. This presentation is like a running presentation. I do it for a while. I usually do it in Hebrew, like part of a one-day seminar that I'm doing in Israel. But currently it's like growing, and the demand to understand what serverless is going all around the world. So I get a lot of invitation to speak in other conferences all around the world, and it's nice. But to be honest, this is my pilot. This is my first time that I'm giving like an international talk about this topic, about serverless. So let's start. Before I will introduce myself, I used to be a CTO and a co-founder in a couple of startups. I come from Israel, from Tel Aviv. So it's not really impressive that I used to be a co-founder of startup, because basically everyone have a startup in Tel Aviv. And currently I'm the founder of Asterix. Asterix is like a leading consulting firm. Basically what we do, we like to research and understand everything is new and trendy about the current technology, and try to understand where it's really fit and give values to business. It's not always a line, like everything that's new and trendy about technology and what really give values and really a game changer for business. But what this basically mean that I'm spending most of my day researching and learning about everything new and cutting edge in technology, as you can see me here developing Jarvis. And surfing. Most of the time I'm surfing, as you can see me here surfing in Tenerife. You really have amazing waves here. How much people here are local from the Canarian? Nice, not a lot. Cool. You have great area, you know? We really love the Canarian. So let's start. The serverless hype. Serverless has become really, really, really trendy right now. Currently, this is from Google Trends. In the last 5 years, we can see how much serverless is growing and booming, how much more and more companies and more industry are entering to the serverless zone. But on the other end, as a developers, as an industry, I feel like we become pretty much exhausted from buzzword. Right? There is always the new best thing. There is always the new best technology. There is always the new things that gonna make a game changer in the industry. And like as the same as buzzword hyping, the same as buzzword are fading away. And it's just take us a lot of time about learning and researching about all this new technology. So what's different about serverless? Why serverless is not just a buzzword? And why I really believe that serverless is here to stay and it's here to be a game changer. First of all, I can see the future. I can really predict that serverless is here to stay, and it's here to be a game changer. And except from this joke, I really want to explain you what serverless is. And after we'll understand what it is, I'm sure that each and everyone here in the audience, it will make him more clear why serverless is here to stay, why serverless is really a game changer, and it's not just a passing buzzword. Serverless, the main point of it, it's really save, it's really make business needs. It's really save us money. It's really saves us time, and it's really make our business evolve. And I will explain. You know, before all this big introduction, I want to explain like really what serverless is. Really understand this definition. I asked before how much people here in the audience heard about serverless, and you said a lot. How much people here in the audience think they really understand what serverless mean? Cool, thanks, appreciate it. How much people here in the audience think that serverless is just Lambda function, or a zoo function or whatever. Thank you, appreciate the honesty again. Thank you. So what serverless really is? What the hell is serverless? Let's try to explain it. We start from a quote, like years ago, way before that Amazon even thought about developing the Lambda. It's a quote from Ken Fromm, and it's basically mean that we are, as an industry, we need to start thinking about our server less. We need to start focusing more about writing code and less focusing about all the heavy infrastructure and all the heavy computing around the scene. It's not just Lambda, this quote is from 2012, I guess. It's way before Lambda even executed and even launched and even was in a pilot. It simply said that as an industry, we need to start thinking on our server less. Thinking on our server less. That's all. And before I will explain in more detail-wise, and we'll use a bit of metaphor to explain what serverless is, I heard a lot of people in the server, in our industry, saying that serverless gonna do to computing what the C language did for programming. And I put here a slide from assembly code. How much people here understand assembly code? Wow, impressive. Our marketing guy asked me about this slide and told me we don't want a more clear slide that people will understand. And I say, you know, anyway, no one understands assembly, so it's not really matter. But I see there's some of people here that do understand. And I heard a lot of people, a lot of big gurus in the software industry saying that serverless is gonna do to computing what C did to programming language. As the same as assembly, this code simply need to run a for loop or doing something really, really simple. As the same as with assembly, we used to write so much code just to do really simple stuff. And after the C language and after more high-level language like Node.js make our life much, much more easier because we lie about abstraction. We don't need to go so much deep about details. And we can focus about writing our code better. We can focus about, you remember this, we can focus about designing our system better. The same that C language changed the game for programmers, it's the same that serverless is going to change the game for the entire software industry. And to explain really what serverless is, I want to use a metaphor. And I will use a metaphor from the car industry. Let's say we go back past in time in history, and we are just in the phase that people start developing cars, and people start riding cars. And it's cool, you know, before we used to ride on a horse and a carriage, and currently the car is developing, and we can take our car and simply ride our car everywhere. But this industry just started, you know, and there is not so much infrastructure for cars. So to really be able to drive my own car, I really need to understand a lot about how cars are manufactured. Really need to understand a lot how to maintain my car. Right, I simply want to drive, but still I need to do a lot of fixing with my cars. If there is any problem with the car, I need to deal with them myself. We go long back in history. And then the car industry evolved, and they become new vendors. And these vendors become the garage. And the garage simply means you can focus more about riding your car, less maintenance. And if there is any problem with the car that you are owning, you can simply bring the car to us. And we, as a provider, will support you with everything that needed for your car to continue running, continue going. Yeah, simple. It makes sense. I want to mainly focus about riding the car. I don't want, as a car owner, to know how to fix everything. So I will go to another provider that will provide me some kind of abstraction that I don't really need to understand how all the engine and under the hood of my car really works. But still, after this the industry of the cars really evolve and change. Because still, even with garage, you know, even if I can take my car and simply take it to the garage, there is still too much stuff that I need to take care of for myself, right? How much people here in the audience owning a car? Cool. How much people in the audience think that owning a car is simply too much configuration? Let's be honest. Too much configuration. We need to do insurance. We need to, you know, take it to the garage once in a while. We need to check our gas. We need to check our oil. We need to always find a parking for our car. And most of the time, we don't really use it. And then the car industry, a new entrepreneur invented a new model. This model is called Car2Go. I'm sure that everyone here in the audience heard about it. Car2Go simply means an abstraction. I can use this car only when I need it. I don't care which, when this car was last time in the garage. I don't care which type of car it is. I don't care if there is oil or if there is enough gas in the car, usually. I don't care where to park it, you know? This, like, vendors even allocate specific parking spots. I don't care what's happening with the car when I'm not using it. I'm simply paying for when I need the car, and I'm simply paying on riding the car. All of this is the metaphor and what is relevant to our industry. Let's go back in time in history for us as an industry. So before there was all this vendor provider for any of us, just to writing code, just to developing application, we was needed to really like doing a lot of manufacturing stuff. There was an IT people in the company that simply building our servers, right? This is all was, I don't know, 20, 30 years ago, before the cloud, even less. There's even companies still working in this model. How much people here come from enterprises? Cool, most of you are startups, yes. So there is still company that work in this model. And it's really like, just for running our code, just for writing quality code and executing my product, I will need a lot of IT, a lot of low-level stuff. And there comes the cloud revolution, and the provider give us more and more abstraction. We don't need all this heavy lifting just to get our product launch. We can lie about cloud that will give us queues and hosting and database and simply run our code, executing our code. But still, even with all of this, and even with the cloud revolution, it still sometimes feels that it's a bit too much configuration, too much heavy lifting for just setting up our application, like running. We simply want to focus about functionality, whereas a programmer only want to write quality code, and only want to give a quality product for our client. Why the hell do we need all this heavy configuration just to make our code running? And as Car2Go, there is a new model. It's called serverless. And I will explain in more detail why is what serverless mean. But as for the metaphor, it's really make everything more clear right now. As same as we don't need to pay on our car when it's standing in the parking, we don't need to pay on our hosting when we don't use it. And I will explain it more detail-wise. The same as I don't care about when the car was in the garage and which type of car I'm running it currently. The same is it, I don't care about which infrastructure I'm running. I really don't care about the operation system. I really don't care about all this heavy lifting. This is a game changer that serverless give us as an industry. We can focus about riding the car. We can focus about developing our product. We don't need to lie so much and to go so detail-wise about all this infrastructure stuff. You know smelly code? You know when you're doing a code review for somebody? And you see the code, and you see that the code is not, you know, you can't really put a finger about what the problem with this code, but you feel this code is not maintainable. You feel this code gonna be difficult to change in the future. You feel it's too much work in this code. You know this? There is a new term, for my opinion. It's called smelly infrastructure. Everyone here that work with the infrastructure team, with the DevOps team, to be honest, it looks like they're doing magic, right? CI/CD and Docker and Kubernetes and all of these heaps of stuff. But really, just feel too much complicated. You know, we can be honest and say it just feels too much complicated, even for DevOps, even for system people, even for backend developers. Why we need all this too much configuration? Why we need all these weird YAML files that can crash our entire application just for a bad space? You know, it feels smelly, just feel not correctly. Remember this quote came from, we need to start thinking as an industry on our server less. We need to focus more on about writing code and thinking on our server less. And this is the main term, server less. It's not mean there is not real servers. It's not mean that there is not physical servers. There is always the car, also in Car2Go. But let's forget about the smelly infrastructure stuff. Let's make our life as a developers and a developer team, as a developer industry, much more easier. What serverless is, in a more detail-wise, serverless, first of all, is a cloud-native strategy. In order to be on serverless, in order for our code to be running on serverless, we need some kind of cloud provider to host our code, right? If you're going to rely on some kind of abstraction of someone else, we need this someone else, this third party, that will host our code. Serverless means, as I explained, there is no management of real service, of real servers. Our code is still running on server, but we, as a developers, don't need to think about it too much. We don't need to manage the server too much. Serverless gives us two huge advantages. One of them is auto-scaling, and the other one is high availability. Everyone here that develops software know how much scaling is difficult, know how much availability of software is difficult. In the serverless phase, in the serverless mindset, you remember, we said like what C did to programming, serverless is going to do to computing. Serverless start make us thinking about this term completely different. Scaling is coming default-wise. Availability is coming default-wise. We don't need to think about high availability. We're changing our mindset to thinking how much time it's going to take our application to init. Or stuff like this. We don't need to think about recovering time. We don't need to think about availability. And another huge thing about serverless, it's a new payment model. It's good for businesses. Us as a developers not always think about this, but it's really good for businesses. It's a new payment model. You pay per use, exactly as Car2Go. And like, if we take out all this buzzword and all this other slide, if we take all this buzzword and all the other slide and take like, this is really feel like, you know, high availability and auto scaling and all this stuff, really feel, cool. This availability, it's looking nice, no? Yeah. High availability and auto scaling and all this kind of stuff really look like stuff that the cloud provider try to sell us, right? Like, what does it really mean high availability? What does it really mean for us as a developer, auto scaling? And I'm not going to go for more details about this. Really, it's a short talk. I give it usually as a one-day seminar. But for us as a developers, as an industry, I think it's important for us to understand and to think about serverless as an abstraction. It's an high-level infrastructure paradigm, no more heavy lifting, when we can focus about code. What it basically means for us, it's an abstraction. The same is C language give abstraction for assembly. Serverless giving abstraction. Oh, this guy killed my concentration. The same is C level. The same is C language give abstraction to assembly. The same thing is serverless gonna give abstraction for computing. We, as an industry, gonna think about our infrastructure from an higher level. I can say that from my own experience, been working on like a more cloud native strategy and currently entering the new phase of serverless, it's make entering new people to the project much more easier. It's make like, if you take like a junior programmer and you simply let him build the entire infrastructure in serverless, it feels so intuitive for him. He don't really care about what's happening like under the hood, you know, he's just lying about abstraction. Kind of, and you know, simply set up the machine that's running the code, simply set up our queue and the hosting of the application, so simple and so straightforward. It gives us abstraction for our infrastructure. This is the main point of this. So I will start and say that serverless is not just a buzzword, right? I talked about how serverless is really going to be the future and how serverless is here for stay, how it's important for all of us to understand and to learn about serverless. And why I think that serverless is the future? Because infrastructure is expensive. Because serverless solves real problem needs. The main point about it, what's the difference between trend, for my opinion, what's the difference between passing trend and something that's going to stick in the industry for us as a developers to know what to learn about, what to focus? Trending is stuff that don't really solve business need. Changing in the industry is stuff that's solving money from the business. If business need less and less infrastructure, less and less management of infrastructure, it saves them money. If business need to pay less about their servers because they're paying only on use, it saves for business money. If it's going to save money for businesses, more and more businesses will want to enter for this serverless age. If more and more businesses will want to enter to the serverless age, more and more developer will be, there will be demand for more and more developer in this age of serverless, in this serverless knowledge. So it's really, it's the problem. It's really the future, because it saves a business need. And I would like to talk about, there's people here in the audience that was honest and said that they're thinking really that serverless is basically just Lambda. And I give her like a couple of other products just from AWS, but there's actually all of the cloud provider currently giving like a lot of, let's say, serverless solution. And the point of this slide and the point of to showing you all of this product was mainly to show that serverless is not just Lambda function. And soon I will explain really what Lambda is really is. But just to show you that serverless does not mean just our code running. There is database that are serverless, there is storage that are serverless, notification serverless, and much more. Serverless means abstraction. I don't need to think so much about my server. I don't need to think so much about my storage. I don't need to think so much about my queue or my database. The cloud provider really gives us abstraction to all of this. Serverless is not just Lambda. Serverless is abstraction. This is the main point. But how is Lambda really fit to the picture? Like, I'm sure a lot of us really heard the term serverless really align and fit with Lambda. And I will want to explain like why Lambda, except for just another serverless solution like DynamoDB or S3, why Lambda really fit and really is a big game changer in all of this serverless, in all of this serverless industry and all of this serverless mindset. And I will explain. For us, we said like before that as an industry, we want to think more about writing more quality code, right? We want to focus less about server and less about stinky and smelly infrastructure. And we want to focus more about writing quality code, right? What we really want to do is to give good product for our clients and really to write cool and effective and maintainable code. If we focus less about servers and more about writing code, we can really shift the entire way we're thinking about our design of the system. We can completely change it. We can think about designing our system differently. Serverless can help us design better architecture, and I will explain. You know this book, Building Microservices, Sam Newman, one of the gurus of the industry. I'm a huge fan of him. And Sam Newman writes a huge book about microservices, how microservices is a game changer and how microservices help us to write better and more quality code. It's mainly focused about backend code, but there is now also in the frontend industry, there is a lot of like micro frontend and all this kind of stuff. And in this short lecture, I can't really explain about what in depth of microservices, but as Sam Newman said, microservices basically are small and autonomous services that work together and module around business domain. Microservice simply means we're taking this huge monolithic of our code and we simply divide it into smaller services because we are focused about writing quality code and it's helped us to maintain and to organize our code better, right? Separate it to services. But microservices, and we all see soon how all of it fits with serverless. Microservices also come with a huge challenges, right? There is a lot of infrastructure, let's say problems, right? If we running one server, there is less infrastructure. If we need to running heaps and a lot of other services, there is a lot of infrastructure work with this. Serverless can really and mainly focus about solving all these problems. A lot of the problem that come to us as an industry about working with microservices come from the infrastructure side and not from the coding side. And if all the infrastructure, if we're relying more about abstraction with the infrastructure, we got this out. You will hear me like this. If we're relying more if we're relying as an industry more about abstraction of the infrastructure, it's with me. This one? No. Too much microphones. You hear me? We are good? Yeah. We need abstraction for microphones. Too much microphones. Oh. I'm gonna go like this. If as an industry we focus less about our servers and more about writing efficient code, then microservices is not the only solution to write quality backend code. Microservices are saying basically, let's design our system better. Let's design our system not just for a huge monolithic code, but let's design our system for smaller chunks of code. But if we don't need to think about infrastructure at all, why not designing our system to think in smaller and smaller chunks of code? Why not taking our entire services and just think about them in more granularic way, in more simple and in more small chunks of code? Why not just designing our entire system into just a function? Remember, there is no infrastructure, there is just code. We're lying about abstraction. It's serverless, there is no real servers. Why not just designing our entire code into function? And I will explain a bit about what I'm talking about, what I'm talking about designing our entire code just as function. I see that most of you are from Spain. How much people here are a fan of some kind of soccer team? Fan of soccer? Yeah, it's easy, you know, Spanish. So if we talk again with the metaphor, and again try to explain it with the metaphor, the monolith code was simply like looking on the entire soccer team as a whole. We don't look in of each individual player, but we just looking on the entire soccer team as chunk, as a big combination of random people that doing random stuff and try to collaborate together. This was basically the monolith. Who is here still having the experience of working on huge monolith stuff, you know? Simply looking on the entire team, not as individual, but squished together. And then there is microservices. And microservices meant that we'll start focus about each individual of the soccer, of our soccer team, as an individual. We don't focus about the team, but we are focused about each and each player and how each and each player are collaborating together. There is the goalkeeper and there is the Messi, basically. And we start thinking about each and each player as a service, how the service are working together and how the service are communicating with each other. But each and each service have his own position and his own goal. But we said that we want as an industry to develop better and more quality code, right? We can think about our server less. And we can see this in even lower resolution. We not need to think only of our team players as a service. We can look about each team players and each position and each responsibilities have and divide it even more into smaller chunks of its pure functionality. Each soccer player, if in the beginning there was a big team, this was the monolith, and then we divide it into services, we can even divide our services into functions. Each soccer player have his own functions, right? Each of them need have the function of running, and each of them have the function of passing the ball. The goalkeeper have the function of catching the ball, and there is a lot of other people in the field that have different functionality. But still, a lot of them have the same functionality. We can do a reuse of soccer player functionality, if you're going to think about it this way. If we are trying to design our system better, and if we are trying to design our system in a new and more granularic and modularic way, we don't just need to think about services. We can think about functions. We can simply focus about each and each function and how all of these functions collaborate together. What it basically means that we can start as an industry, develop our entire backend just based on functions. No more service, no more monolithic code. We can just write small functions, we can make them easily deployed, and we can make this function collaborate and working together. And what Lambda really is? Lambda is running function without servers, without thinking about servers. Lambda is a product of AWS, but the same as Lambda, there is Azure Function, and there is a Google Cloud Function, and there is heaps of more. But let's focus about Lambda. Lambda basically means that we can look about our function as services. We don't need to think about monolithic or basically services.
We can simply use our entire function as a whole, as something complete, something that can be deployable, and something that can work together with other functions in order to make our entire system work and functional together. Lambda min is function. Lambda is a serverless solution. And the point about Lambda is that it's event-driven. What it means by event-driven? It means that most of the time our code in the Lambda is just sitting somewhere and not really executing, not really running anywhere. Whenever there is kind of event, like all of this event that's creating here and much more, like event in the storage or event in the database or event in the HTTP request, our code simply wake up to life. It's doing what it needs to do, and then it simply passed and die again. We don't need to pay on the time that our code didn't run. We don't need to maintain the server for make all this code running. We don't need a lot of health checking just to check if our code is running and available or not available. Right? Our code simply executed when it needed. Our code simply executed based on events. And more about this, we said there is no more health checking and there is no more availability. And we don't need to think even more about scaling. The best thing about Lambda is that it really gives us auto-scaling. Based off any request, based on any event, this Lambda simply init a new machine of code, a new functionality of code, and simply can handle a new request. We, as a developer, don't care if we have only if we have zero requests or we have 1,000 requests, or we have much more. The Lambda solution can simply solve and maintain all this scaling stuff. And I will finish with this, and I would just want to, I have some more time, and just want to give like my own opinion. And there is a great talk of Robert C. Martin, Uncle Bob, and he's talking about the future of programming. And he really talk about all of us as an industry. And what he's saying, it's, I don't know if it's so relevant to here, but what he's basically saying that we need to take more responsibility on the stuff that we are writing as an industry. What does it mean? It means that every year there is more and more demand of writing code. There is code basically everywhere. There is code in planes, and there is code in cars. And there is basically code that's running and executing everywhere. And there is more and more demand for people that's writing code, right? On the other end, there is not so much people that can really educate and can really train all these new people. All these new programmers that need to write code that fly our airplanes, need to write code that drive our cars, need to write code that take care of our health. There is not so much people in this industry to train them and to educate them. And one of the solutions that we are developing as an industry is abstraction. If before there was needed much more coder to write assembly code with the C programming language or with Node, we need less and less programmers to do more jobs. If we can lie about abstraction, we, as an industry, can write more code with less people. We, as an industry, it's bad to say it, but we, as an industry, can write more quality product with less efficient people. We need to think about it. Like in the couple of years, in the 5 or 10 or 20 years, there will be much more of us, much more programmers. Not all of them going to be so efficient. Not all of them going to understand the deep part of their application that they're writing. If we as an industry can solve and can think about more about abstraction and developing abstraction solution, we as an industry can bring more valuable product and more like a plane that don't crash for bad code or car that don't crash for bad code as an industry. And serverless is really one of the greater solution for this abstraction that's available today. Thanks. Cool. Any questions? Yeah.
Thank you for your talk.
Thanks.
I would like to ask you about if the request for the serverless Lambda, for example,
yeah,
and our solution based on server, go too high, it won't be cheaper and equal efficient to run in, for example, in Kubernetes solution in the cloud, because I have some concerns about that.
What you're basically asking, if I summarize it, if running my code on a serverless will be more cheap than running my code on cloud Kubernetes or any other solution, right? Mm-hmm. From like a pricing perspective.
Yes.
And it's a big question, and it's really depend. This is my main answer, it's depend. Because the point about Kubernetes solution, it will be a bit more cheap about running the code in a serverless environment. Serverless is more managed environment, so it will be more expensive. But on the other end, it depends how much your code is needed to be running and needed to be executed. The most amazing thing about serverless that we don't pay on our code when it's not running. And it's the same if I to give you a good answer, if I will use my metaphor again, it depends how much time you need your car. If you need your car only once a week, going car to go will be much more cheap than going owning your own car. But if you're a taxi driver and your car working 24/7, it's not make sense to working in car to go. The serverless solution really good if your code is not running 24/7, or if you don't have, I don't know, depend about the amount of scaling you have. If you have like 10 servers that need to run 24/7 all the time, then maybe Lambda is not really the exact solution for this. If sometimes you need one server or sometimes you need 10, it's really fit for this. And another answer I have for you, there is also serverless with like Kubernetes and container solution. There is called, Frago from AWS. It's a bit more cheap than Lambda, but it can give you more or less both of the side. Also Kubernetes and also cheaper solution, but more abstract and less configuration.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
May I ask another question?
You give him another question? It's democratic, yeah, it's yours. Right. This actually, what you're saying now, it's one of the biggest problem about serverless. If we lie more about solution of like AWS, we're lying more about Lambda, we're lying more about DynamoDB, it's give us vendor locking, really. The current solution for this is what I recommend enterprises to do. It's don't look about vendor locking as a bad perspective. Currently, vendor locking in all the cloud industry really become like a honey trap. We're kind of trapped there, but there is so much honey that is simply amazing. And on the other end, we can develop a strategic what happened in the day that we need to leave the cloud provider. There is a lot of solution to this. Even if you're lying about serverless, in the day that if, I don't know, your company stop working with AWS and you want to shift for another vendor, there is solution how to do this. It's a bit expensive, definitely. It's a plan B solution, but it makes sense. It still makes sense working serverless this way. Any more questions?
What's yes? Your opinion about the blockchain in the serverless space?
Serverless and blockchain together? There is currently all the blockchain is also a game changer, definitely. And there is currently a lot of startup that's starting to developing a cloud solution based on blockchain, based on crypto. And it simply means that I'm guessing that in the last 10 or 15 years, we're gonna start using less and less vendors for our cloud, and we're gonna start using more and more community solution for our cloud. It's gonna be a cloud community based on the crypto solution. And back there, as an industry, as the same as that enterprises that was backing programming language did a less good job, let's say, than the community developing programming language, I'm guessing that the same, the vendor, the developing cloud will do less efficient job than the community developing cloud. So the serverless solution and all this crypto cloud are just gonna grow and align and booming together. But it's need more time, for my opinion, just to fit to the industry. Thanks. Good question. Yeah. Anyone else who's brave enough? Cool, that's all. Thank you. Thank you.